the Mughal Empire, an ancient Gurkhani empire that was located within the Indian subcontinent. Founded in 1526, a tremendous amount of information regarding this group of warriors has subsequently been unearthed over the centuries. A wealth of archaeological information, which has offered a glimpse back into our distant past, revealing many things about this ancient people, which, for a time, was lost in antiquity. However, although extensive archaeological exploration has unraveled many of the Mughals' mysterious existence, there remains a most perplexing enigma. In the 1980s, Smithsonian historian Emily Savage Smith embarked on a journey to acquire a set of perplexing ancient artifacts, now known as celestial spheres. Plotted upon the underside of a dome or hemispherical screen, the celestial sphere is a practical tool for astronomy even to this day, allowing the observers to plot positions of objects in the sky when distances are unknown or trivial. Most, as one would presume, display a primitive understanding of astronomical arrangements. However, some reluctantly revealed to the academic world, and since quietly archived away from inquisitive souls, have stumped all who have attempted to explain them, based solely upon modern historical conformities. The majority of celestial spheres acquired can be cataloged into two distinct types: seamed spheres and their more elaborate, thus greatly more problematic counterparts, seamless spheres. Seamed spheres are, or were, made by molding two halves of the sphere separately and then soldering them together. The artisans and astronomers would then collaboratively engrave the surface. Seamless spheres, however, are another thing entirely. Up until Savage Smith made her discovery, it was thought by virtually all within the academic community, including metallurgists the world over, that all examples of hollow metal celestial spheres were of the seamed type. This owing to the long-held belief that creating seamless hollow metal spheres was impossible. As it turns out, it isn't. The most exquisite surviving example of a hollow seamless celestial sphere is one that is said to have been made by a Mughal metallurgical master named Muhammad Salid Tatawi in 1631. Although, conveniently, it is unknown just how he figured out how to make the sphere, or indeed fill it accurately with astronomical information we have only recently confirmed is accurate. It makes one wonder, just how did he learn such a technique, if, of course, it was he who created it? With no evidence to suggest that the Mughals could have even cast the bronze needed to create the sphere, you have to wonder, just where did they get this information from? Were the ancient Mughals visited by a race of ancient extraterrestrial beings? Did they discover a relic, an artifact, left by a vastly more ancient lost civilization, which they claimed as their own? Unfortunately, the subject of seamless celestial spheres is little known within mainstream antiquity, and as such, in the few places they are discussed, the facts are often distorted or even completely made up. They are most certainly out-of-place artifacts, which some have attempted to brush beneath a rug of convolution. We always perceive this method of concealment to be strong evidence of a conspiracy. Just who could have made the Mughal celestial spheres? And more importantly, how did they make them? Perhaps one day, we will find out the truth.
Homes, towns, religious structures, an entire living infrastructure of a once highly successful, highly capable people. Managing to expertly fuse their existence harmoniously with the surrounding environment, creating structures which left little, if any, impact on the surrounding landscape, structures still usable even to this day. Located within Abanque, a province in the region of Apurimac, Sehuite has been conveniently dated to the period of the Incan Empire, between the 15th and 16th centuries AD. However, like many sites dotted around Peru, and indeed the world, an explanation as to how these cultures achieved such wonders with such primitive access to construction or tools is not forthcoming. Compared to other Incan sites, Sehuite is also a complete ruin. leading the more observant, and indeed the free-thinking, self-funded geologist among us, to suspect that it may actually be even older than the pre-Incas responsible for Machu Picchu. Yet the most noteworthy object at Sehuite, and the reason for our video, is its monolith. A mysterious boulder drenched in intricate, purposely placed carvings. Interestingly, the word Sehuite originated from the Quechua word Sehueta, which translates as place of orientation. The site is located on the top of a terraced hill. Dedicated research has also revealed that the site was once home to an enclosed sanctuary. Yet all that remains of this sanctuary today is a few leveled platforms and the monolith. It contains more than 200 geometric and zoomorphic figures, including reptiles, frogs, felines, topographical hydraulic models, complete with terraces, ponds, rivers, tunnels, and irrigation channels. The functions or purposes of the stone are not academically known, yet others suspect it was a map of the once existing complex created by a culture able of moving tremendous weights and carving stone with relative ease. Researcher Dr. Arlen Andrews Sr. believes the monolith was used as a scale model to design, develop, test, and document the water flow for public water projects, and to teach ancient engineers and technicians the concepts and practices required. Quote, "The rock was edited several times with new material, either altering the paths of the water or adding routes altogether," end quote. Clearly a remarkable artifact left by a remarkable civilization. Thanks for watching, guys, and until next time, take care.
In 1963, NASA launched its final manned mission during the Mercury program. On board the Atlas IX rocket known as Faith 7 was pilot astronaut Gordon Cooper. Project Mercury was the first human spaceflight program of the United States, running from 1958 through 1963. An early highlight of the space race, its goal was to put a man into Earth orbit and return him safely before the Russians. Cooper's cool-headed performance and piloting skills led to a basic rethinking of design philosophy for later space missions. While Cooper was stuffed into his tiny module for 32 hours during his orbit, he was tasked with a covert mission, the results of which have only recently come to light. He was given a cutting-edge piece of long-range magnetic detection technology, which was installed into a camera on board the Faith 7 spacecraft. His mission while on board was to capture images of the globe using this sensing technology to locate any possible secret nuclear development sites, which could be considered a threat to America. During this procedure, Cooper became aware of an amazing capability which the camera possessed. Not only was it sensing possible hidden bases, but was also capturing anomalies deep in the oceans of Earth. Cooper deduced that these pings were actually all the shipwrecks which dot the ocean floors from throughout history, which had been spotted by the machine due to the considerable amount of metals within the wrecks. It seems having the courage to go into space, and the intelligence and reflexes to survive the experience, will endow you with some very special rewards, in the most unlikely of forms. What this mission had given to Cooper was a treasure map of Earth, which no other person could possibly possess. Cooper dutifully recorded the geographical coordinates of the anomalies as was required of him, and when he returned to Earth, he also mapped them out on a sea chart, which became known as the treasure map from space, by his lifelong friend and renowned treasure hunter, Roger Milkos. Throughout the rest of his life, Cooper would secretly compile substantial research regarding historical shipwrecks that corresponded with the locations on the space map. Cooper had planned to organize expeditions to find the treasures, but unfortunately, before he could finish his work, he died in 2004 of heart failure, passing his map and all accompanying research to Milkos on his deathbed. Now Milkos has set about finding these shipwrecked treasures in a new Discovery Channel series called Cooper's Treasure. He told the press, quote, "We want to bring to light the new stories of the shipwrecks that have yet to be discovered, tell the story and share it with the world, and share it with the host countries that are allowing us to do the research. What we are trying to do is to open a dialogue about the past with these host countries," end quote. "I will keep you posted on any substantial finds they make."
There are a number of artifacts, which can still be found all over the Earth, that are extremely hard for modern academia to explain, using their popularly attested and often regurgitated views regarding chronological timelines of the developments of man. Most of these surviving objects are locked away within the collections of wily individuals, people aware of the many other such artifacts which have been found, stolen, and never seen again. These guardians of the artifacts have often encountered attempted robberies, switch tactics, and often offered large sums of money to allow these artifacts to just simply vanish. Yet fortunately, many still cling to existence thanks to a handful of individuals guided by a moral duty to share them with the world. And our next artifact could be seen as such an object. Known as the Dashka Stone, it is a controversial artifact that it is believed by some to be the guidelines used by the quote, architect of the world. Also known as the map of the creator, the Dashka Stone tablet has baffled researchers since its discovery in 1999. And as impossible as it may seem, a number of specialist Russian experts, after in-depth analysis of the stone, have concluded that it is indeed a stone map that is as much as 120 million years old. Created from a bird's-eye view, presumably from space, the Dashka slabs depicts in detail the peaks and valleys of the Ural Mountains. Although mainstream academia will simply deny the possibility of the Dashka's true purpose, and indeed age, many who have researched, mapped, and analyzed the slab have concluded that it is indeed somehow authentic and well over 100 million years old. Initially discovered by archaeologists from the Bashkir State University, it was actually found within the Ural Mountains of eastern Russia. Researchers were understandably stunned when they realized that the tablet displayed a highly accurate topographical map of Bashkiria, a specific area of the Ural Mountains, at a scale of approximately 1 inch to 1 kilometer. The map of the creator also retained clues to its artificial origins within its structure, comprised of three layers, each of which strongly suggesting to geologists that it did not originate in nature, but was indeed artificially created deep within antiquity. The first layer is roughly 7 inches of a primitive cement ceramic compound. The second layer is roughly 1 inch thick, made of diopside glass, enriched with silicon, and the third layer, a mere few millimeters thick, is made of a calcium porcelain mixture. Who created the Dashka slab? Did they really create it over 120 million years ago, like many specialists have reluctantly become convinced is the case? It is unquestionably a remarkable object, and one which deserves a lot more attention.
Throughout my time investigating the mystery of Oak Island, the possible existence of treasure, the artifacts, and most notably the people who have been involved, I have realized something that will become evident to anyone willing to delve into the vast amount of information available regarding the quest. The road to, shall we say, enlightenment, is very bumpy indeed, filled with outlandish claims, theories and accusations, ready to pull your attention in many different directions, mostly leading you to dead ends, all for what lay at the bottom of a pit, on a small island among many, in a quiet corner of the world, called Nova Scotia. Confusion will envelop and inevitable defeat will beckon, to any susceptible victim. All this, I suspect, is by design. You see, I have found patterns during my investigations, things and information that people have worked very hard to keep concealed for many years. This information would lead me on a journey of first curiosity, then skepticism, then disbelief, to ultimate amazement. When researching the quest, many people have very interesting theories, but they are all lacking in hard evidence. There is, however, a theory that exists for the island that does involve evidence and implicates an awful lot of people in support of it. I became shocked to find that certain groups of people have been aware of what has been hidden on the island since around the time it was buried, or very shortly after. I have also established that the original story of McGuinness and his friends to be that of a fictional one, stuffed full of Masonic symbology and designed to create a stir of interest around the island. There was indeed a group of individuals that needed help in finding the treasure, however, due to the evidence I have uncovered, the story of the boys locating the treasure is now highly unlikely. The Masonic symbology make it nothing more than a coded mockery thrown at the public. The Onslow Company, for instance, supposedly set up by the boys shortly after they and only they knew of the pit's existence, was completely made up of Freemasons of the time. My accusation would clearly be that the Freemasons knew what was hidden on the island. This would only be a suspected accusation were it not for Father Lavener Johnson, a highly regarded Freemason, actually publishing what could only be described as a confession in the form of a pamphlet, which is available on the web, where he confirms he knows the whereabouts of the Oak Island treasure map, and details some of the artifacts on the island key to unlocking the treasure's location. My previous two videos go into detail regarding the Masonic connection throughout the years, the public and not so public figures involved in the hunt, including presidents and kings of England. Their connections to the island allow you, by logic, to abandon all other theories that do not involve Freemasonry, most notably is the connection found in the private documents of a deceased 33rd degree Mason, where it describes the Order of the Templar, cornered in Glastonbury. This key fragment of information is more important than the stone tablet in unlocking the treasure. The Freemasons in the late 1600s were consuming and destroying the Templars. The last remaining knights in England were holed up in Glastonbury, coincidentally where the UK holds its largest music festival each year. They had in their possession their last remaining and most important treasure, the Holy Grail. The Prime Minister of England at the time was trying to seize it from them, with the power of the King and Masons behind him. There are secret societies that have been able to communicate over continents for hundreds of years, famously bragging in doing so, such as Jesuit order priests being quoted as such. The chalice somehow managed to escape. The note details the captured knights being led to the Tower of London for torture. Strong evidence exists that the knights were able to travel the world. For example, Templar clothing has been found buried in a churchyard in England, with Egyptian stones sewn into them, linking to recorded accounts of Knights Templar in the locations at the time. The knights tortured in the tower, presumably, eventually told them of the island, or they found out about its location by other means. There the English and the Masons locate the tackle block and the fresh depression in the ground, linking to public knowledge of the history of the island. If you were hiding a treasure on an island that your enemy may be looking for, and you are a religious Templar, what would you do? What would you do to assure that if you cannot come back for it in the near future and someone may be digging for it, what would you do to give yourself peace of mind, that they would never find it? Once this scenario enters the equation, things begin to make sense. The stones that are believed to have religious importance, the coconut fibers, the cross covering the span of the island, and most importantly the booby trap. They are also records and evidence of an ammo dump being dug in on the island. In all possibility, the Templars ordered this dig, and then finally tunneled to hide the treasure and complete the booby traps. I also found out from Leavener, and also confirming the calculation's authenticity myself, that the Freemasons did eventually figure out where the real treasure map was, not the decoy stone tablet within the pit. Not before a few dozen of his pals demolished half the island, blown up half the shoreline with dynamite, and carved into the bedrock of earth, of course. If you were hiding a treasure, why would you go to the trouble of carving a substitution cipher into a stone tablet, encouraging people to dig further, when they have already got to 90 feet looking for it? The reason would be to keep your treasure hidden, rather than expose its location in a place where the diggers for it would already be. You would create it in such a way that anyone reading it would continue to dig, and only a few more feet would set off the booby trap, flooding the treasure shaft forever. They figured out where the treasure map was, the true one, not the decoy stone tablet. The cross that was found on Oak Island is the actual treasure map. I will put the info up on how they worked it out now. With this information, you can also establish why they haven't just dug it up. Whoever figured out the map is pretty smart. They figured out and even explained how the knights hid the dots of the cross's angles to conceal the directions further. If we were in 1795, then the map would point us to the treasure via true north. But since the poles are constantly shifting location, the Masons have no way of knowing where true north was in 1795. The map is useless, and because the tunnels are flooded, the treasure may indeed be lost forever. The stone tablet has also proven to be a huge success as a distraction. When the initial retrieval dig was happening and the stone was uncovered, they even failed to decode the simple cipher, deciding to continue digging anyway, so in reality they set off the trap without the stone tablet even being a factor. The person or people who figured out how to hide this artifact were smart enough to realize that the people coming for it would dig in greed, and were able to create a booby trap for a treasure in the 1700s that uses the entire sea as its guard, and that no one until now has been able to figure out what they did or how they did it, maybe even knowing that as time goes on, it would become harder and harder to recover it, until it now seems impossible. The cross, which is indeed the real treasure map, is a Christian cross. Lots more overwhelming evidence linking the religious Templars, Christianity and Masons to the island now exists in my possession, linking this to the information found in a Freemason's possessions, and also adding a public confession from a Masonic priest which displays what they know. Why they haven't found what's there shows that they do indeed seem desperate to save it from the sea, or desperate to have it in their hands. This is indeed the most likely reason, I feel, that I and others have been encouraged to devote time, energy, finances and knowledge to the subject in question. It seems from the start this was their plan, to create a story surrounding a treasure, conveniently, no one could tie to anyone, or find a suitable candidate for hiding, with physical historical data or evidence alone anyway. A cover-up, as it were. in its place, to create a fantastic story, one that would quench any treasure hunter's curiosities as to confirmation that they were indeed looking for payload. All the while attempting to, and to a certain degree successfully concealing the true nature of this treasure hunt, the true nature of the importance of the pit, and the fact that many have died in their effort to conceal it from certain entities. Unfortunately for them, however, they have left a trail, a connection that for a very long time remained hidden behind secret rites and rituals, behind closed doors of rich lodges, and even the White House. This connection is overwhelming, their involvement is such, which continues to this day, sure confirmation that they haven't got their hands on it yet. Please do not comment with doubts surrounding these connections and also criticizing my research without first reviewing all of which I have put forward thus far in the previous videos. Thank you. This quest has led us full circle to this point. It seems Keith Ranville's work, in which I initially looked into on these videos, regarding other possible tunnels is indeed intriguing. The fact that he has discovered evidence of other shafts and possible treasure shafts, leading from the money pit, means our research and the conclusive theory thereof have met and joined the same track of thinking. This is becoming very interesting indeed. All paths seem to be leading to Rome. Let's just hope there isn't a sword at the end.